Hey, Squirrel Squad listeners. Try to get this up. Yeah, I know I had this shirt on yesterday, but then I changed because it got really hot. So, cut off on me yesterday, so I'm sure it probably will again today. Whoops. Okay. Hang on. I have it marked. Where is it? Here it is. And I may be going back and reading a little bit of what I read before it cut off on me. Diana Barry's beauty of crimson cheek and black curls was much more to Charlotte of the Fourth's taste than Anne's moonshine charm of luminous gray eyes and the pale, ever-changing roses of her cheeks. "But I'd rather look like you than be pretty," she told Anne sincerely. Anne laughed, sipped the honey from the tribute, and cast away the sting. She was used to taking her compliments mixed. Public opinion never agreed on Anne's looks. People who heard her called handsome met her and were disappointed. People who had heard her called plain saw her and wondered where other people's eyes were. Anne herself would never believe that she had any claim to beauty when she looked in the glass. All she saw was a little pale face with 7 freckles on the nose thereof. Her mirror more revealed to her the elusive, ever-varying play of feeling that came and went over her features like a rosy, illuminating flame, or the charm of dream and laughter alternating in her big eyes. While Anne was not beautiful in any strictly defined sense of the word, she possessed a certain evasive charm and distinction of appearance that left beholders with a pleasurable sense of satisfaction in that softly rounded girlhood of hers, with all its strongly felt potentialities. Those who knew Anne best felt, without realizing what they felt it, that her greatest attraction was the aura of possibility surrounding her, the power of future development that was in her. She seemed to walk in an atmosphere of things about to happen. As they picked, Charlotta the Fourth confided to Anne her fears regarding Miss Lavendar. The warm-hearted little handmaiden was honestly worried over her adored mistress's condition. "Miss Lavendar isn't well, Miss Shirley, ma'am." "I'm sure she isn't, though she never complains. She hasn't seemed like herself this long while, ma'am, not since the day you and Paul were here together before. I feel sure she caught cold that night, ma'am, after you and him had gone. She went out and walked in the garden for long after dark with nothing but a little shawl on her. There was a lot of snow on the walks, and I feel sure she got a chill, ma'am. Ever since then, I've noticed her acting tired and lonesome-like. She don't seem to take an interest in anything, ma'am. She never pretends company's coming, nor fixes up for it. Nor nothing, ma'am. It's only when you come she seems to chirk up a bit. And the worst sign of all, Miss Shirley, ma'am," Charlotta the Fourth lowered her voice as if she were about to tell some exceedingly weird and awful symptom indeed, "is that she never gets cross now when I break things. Why, Miss Shirley, ma'am, yesterday I broke her green and yaller bowl that's always stood on the bookcase. Her grandmother brought it out from England, and Miss Lavendar was awful choice of it. I was dusting it just as careful, Miss Shirley, ma'am, and it slipped out so fashion afore I could grab hold of it, and it broke into about 40 million pieces. I tell you, I was sorry and scared. I thought Miss Lavendar would scold me awful, ma'am, and I'd rather she had than take it the way she did. She just come in and hardly looked at it and said, 'It's no matter, Charlotta, take up the pieces and throw them away. Just like that, Miss Shirley, ma'am, take up the pieces and throw them away. As if it wasn't her grandmother's ball from England. Oh, she isn't well, and I feel awful bad about it. She's got nobody to look after her but me. Hang on, gotta wet the whistle already. Early morning mouth issues. Look. Gulp. Let's see. Nobody look after her but me. Okay. Charlotta the Fourth's eyes brimmed up with tears. Anne patted the little brown paw holding the cracked pink cup sympathetically. I think Miss Lavendar needs a change, Charlotta. She stays here alone too much. Can't we induce her to go away for a little trip? Charlotta shook her head with its rampant bows disconsolately. I don't think so, Miss Shirley, ma'am. Miss Lavendar hates visiting. She's only got 3 relations she ever visits, and she says she just goes to see them as family duty. Last time when she come home, she said she wasn't going to visit for family duty no more. I've come home in love with loneliness, Charlotta, she says to me, and I never want to stray from my own vine and fig tree again. My relations try so hard. Hang on. To make an old lady of me, and it has a bad effect on me just like that. Miss Shirley, ma'am, it has a very bad effect on me, so I don't think it would do any good to coax her to go visiting. We must see what can be done, said Anne decidedly as she put the last possible berry in her pink cup. Just as soon as I have my vacation, I'll come through and spend a whole week with you. We'll have a picnic every day and pretend all sorts of interesting things. And see if we can cheer Miss Lavendar up. That will be the very thing, Miss Shirley, ma'am, exclaimed Charlotta the Fourth in rapture. She was glad for Miss Lavendar's sake, and for her own, too. With a whole week in which to study Anne constantly, she would surely be able to learn how to move and behave like her. When the girls got back to Echo Lodge, they found that Miss Lavendar and Paul had carried the little square table out of the kitchen to the garden and had everything ready for tea. Nothing ever tasted so delicious as those strawberries and cream eaten under a blue sky, all curdled over with fluffy white little clouds, and in long shadows of the wood with its lispings and its murmurings. After tea, Anne helped Charlotta wash the dishes in the kitchen, while Miss Lavendar sat on the stone bench with Powell and heard all about his rock people. She was a good listener, this sweet Miss Lavendar, but just at the last it struck Powell that she had suddenly lost interest in the twin sailors. "Miss Lavendar, why do you look at me like that?" he asked gravely. "How do I look, Powell?" "Just as if you were looking through me at somebody I put you in mind of." "We know who that is," said Paul, who had such occasional flashes of uncanny insight that it wasn't quite safe to have secrets when he was about. "You put me in mind of somebody I knew long ago, too," said Miss Lavendar dreamily. "When you were young?" "Yes, when I was young. Do I seem very old to you, Paul?" "Do you know, I can't make up my mind about that," said Paul confidentially. "Your hair looks old. I've never knew a young person with white hair. But your eyes are as young as my beautiful teacher's when you laugh. I'll tell you what, Miss Lavendar," Paul's voice and face were as solemn as a judge's, "I think you would make a splendid mother. You have just the right look in your eyes. The look my little mother always had. I think it's a pity you haven't any boys of your own. I have a little dream boy, Paul. Oh, you have? Really? How old is he? About your age, I think. He ought to be older because I dreamed him long before you were born. But I'll never let him get any older than 11 or 12 because if I did someday, he might grow up altogether and then I'd lose him. I know, nodded Paul. That's the beauty of dream people. They stay any age you want them to. You and my beautiful teacher and me, myself, are the only folks in the world that I know of that have dream people. Isn't it funny and nice we should all know each other? I guess that kind of people always find each other out. Grandma never has dream people, and Mary Jo thinks I'm wrong in the upper story because I have them. But I think it's splendid to have them, you know, Miss Lavendar. Tell me all about your little dream boy. He has blue eyes and curly hair. He steals in and awakens me with a kiss every morning. Then all day he plays here in the garden and I play with him. Such games as we never had. We run races and talk with the echoes and I tell him stories. And when the twilight comes... I know, interrupted Paul eagerly. He comes and sits beside you, so, because of course at 12 he's too big to climb into your lap, and lays his head on your shoulder, so, and you put your arms around him and hold him tight, tight, and rest your cheek on his head. Yes, that's the very way. Oh, you do know, Miss Lavendar. Anne found the two of them there when she came out of the stone house. And something in Miss Lavendar's face made her hate to disturb them. I'm afraid we must go, Paul, if we want to get home before dusk. Miss Lavendar, I'm going to invite myself to Echo Lodge for a whole week pretty soon. If you come for a week, I'll keep you for two, threatened Miss Lavendar. And that's the end of chapter 27. So, today is Friday, TGIFers. So, I hope you will have a lovely day. And don't forget, live at 5, tea with Granny D today. Set an alarm. You know those old notifications don't work. Hope to see you then. Until then, and always, be sweet. Don't be ugly. Love you. Bye-bye.